you getting yourself ready for our show?
Guys, Jigs and Bigs, another Tuesday here. It's Bobby Roast Beef. We've got an awesome show lined up for you. Lots of fun to be had. It's, you know, you guys know that we're in this weird time of year right now, but we got actually a lot to talk about. Sean and I have spent the last 7 days working tirelessly on lots of different projects, actually. We're going to share some info that we can right now because we don't want to let too much out of the bag, but we'll get there. We have a little bit of... Well, we have in this week's Hot Topic, we got a couple things we want to mention, one of which is wrapped around an upcoming event that you're not going to want to miss. It's very, very exciting. We also have some info for you guys regarding all this tournament stuff that we're doing. Like, we're going to learn a little bit about that shit. It's going to be good. And just the tip this week, we're continuing our discussion on tackle storage systems. Sean is going to take us on his boat, and he's going to tell us all about what's going on with the tackle storage and organization. And it's okay. We're going to learn a lot, but it's about the implication. That's what really matters. It's about the implication. Some of you will know what I'm leaning at there. As far as we have a bizarre FTG this week. Sit and stay tuned for that. Yes, are we scraping the bottom of the barrel here? Yes, but it's a very, very odd and random tale. Guys, we have so much good stuff coming up for you this week. Sadly, no interview this week, so we're going to have a short, sweet episode, but we got some jig heads in here. We've got all kinds of good friends going to be leaving some comments, and all sorts of great stuff coming up in just a bit. Trust me, guys, you don't want to miss it. We got much more show coming up right after this. That's what we do here, guys. We start a show, and it comes in rocking, and we just let it rip, man. And we got good stuff happening. Sean, how are you this week, buddy?
Well, I feel a little tired, a little down. I went ahead and got shot number 3 the other day, a little booster action, so I'm a little...
You got boosted.
I got boosted, man. I'm a little fatigued.
Fatigued, it happens. It comes into the territory, man.
A little fatigued. Took a lot of naps today.
Yep.
But... You know, it is what it is. These are the end days.
I do have my appointment. I think it's Monday. Yeah, I think it's Monday now that I think about it. Yep, it's Monday. I'm excited. You know, where I got that to look forward to. So you know, should be an interesting week. Odd week this week coming up for me for work and everything. Like, I got additional events. I had an event that got bumped to a holiday party that got bumped until March because the venue wanted to bump it. So it was a little bit odd. I have something good to look forward to this week, man. My wife and I are going to see an amazing comedian that we really, really love in Boston at the Orpheum. Second row.
Awesome.
Yeah, Louis C.K., it's going to be good.
Ooh, there you go.
Yeah, we're big fans. Ironically, Louis was the last show that we saw right before everything shut down. It was like one of two shows he did in America, and it happened to be in Albany, and we caught wind, and I said, I just bought tickets. I was like, I know Holly wanted to go, so I'm like, let's do it. We went. Had a great time. It was over the Egg. Very, very interesting place to see a show if you've ever seen, especially stand-up. Like, you can fit a lot of people in there, but it doesn't feel like an arena or a theater or anything. It's very, very unique, but really, really cool stuff.
Awesome.
Yeah, very cool. So that's this week. Last week, your boy fished. He got out. He got out, and I think if there's anything that I want to stress to anybody who's listening right now, and you guys know, I say it in the interview questions all the time when I ask about preferences for bodies of water. You know, current is the last stuff to freeze. Get comfortable with your rivers. You know, I mean, if you can get around in those areas, get comfortable. Because that's what I was doing. And I mean, was it tough? Yeah, I was actually, I got out twice. Both times were absolutely fruitless. Not fruitless if you're considering making donations of blade baits to river systems. There was a couple of losses that happened the first time out. Second time out, I went to a staple, Western Massachusetts fishery, one that I have a personal grudge against. And I was looking at different spots, a little more of an urban setting, and got into it. It was nice. I think I basically went out there to kind of scout some spots, like as things kind of continue to get cool. And I'm looking, I'm that desperate to try to wet a line without having a big, you know, rush to get out on the ice or anything like that, which for right now, I'll take these little river runs. You know,
nice.
It's like you're very limited, but like, you know, it's so cold. Like, I think, what was it, like 34, 35 degrees the first day I was out. And it was a little bit warmer the second time I was out. So it's like your body's not going to let you hang out in that cold. Your fingers aren't going to be able to handle it if you're not gloved up or anything. No glove, no love. You know what they say?
Love, glove.
Oh, God. Yeah, and Gravy chimes in. He says 50 degrees tomorrow. That's the thing. It's bananas.
Yeah.
Air temp is ridiculous.
I do tend to wear, I have two different pairs. I think one's an NRS pair and the other's a Bass Pro or Berkley or Cabela's, a bigger name brand of neoprene gloves. I do wear those out when it's cold. So those are useful, but I mean, your fingers do still get cold if you're popping the tabs and making your fingertips come out so you can actually feel stuff. It happens.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, one of our past guests had Sean Snover. He had on his live show, they did a winter gear breakdown, and there's a company, I think it's FXR, and he was talking about like recommended products and everything, and there's a glove that they put out that I think it might be the best, like the move for me anyway. It's basically a fingerless glove that has a mitten pullover.
Yep.
And I'm like, there was a couple of other things on there. Like, it looks like it might be an ideal sort of situation, kind of like, for whether it be for ice fishing or just cold water fishing or something like that. Like, it's not a bad thing. You know, a mitten is nice because it allows your hand to actually warm up really, really well. You know, it's really, especially like if you put one of those hand warmer things in there. Those things are awesome.
Yeah. I'll check them out, man. That sounds like it's good stuff.
So I would say, I mean, I know people are catching fish. They're out there and they are catching them, which is good. Sean and myself both were treated to a lovely display of photographs from one of our jig heads, one and only Mr. Tim Jakes, who got on some smallmouth and decided to take some very artful photographs with them and text them to us. Yes, you can see them on his Instagram. He shared almost all of them, except one that is just for us.
And I'm blind.
Exactly. Yeah.
Tim got us good.
Tim is a guy who tans up very, very nice, but when you get to like October, November, that shit goes bye-bye.
Nope. Yep. Tim, you got us good. Blinding. Thank you. That was awesome. Good job with the fishing. Bad job with the photography.
Photography was epic. I didn't know how to feel. Gravy Fishing jumps in here and he says, I know up in the Shears that there is ice. A pond in Heath, Mass at 3 inches as of Wednesday last week. 3 inches is a lot. That's pretty good. But, you know, what we need are those really cold, consistent lows. We get those, and that's where we're going to start seeing them like really kind of stack on. Ryan Bogley jumps in here, says river is still producing. You're damn right. And you know, I owe this train of thought really to our past guest that we had on, Bass Queen, when she said, she's like, yeah, in the winter I hit the river. And I was like, you know what, I've got this amazing resource right here. I just need to get a little bit more comfortable with finding spots along the river, you know, and making it work for me. I'm like, because I'll go out there for especially these short bank trips, like during the week, all winter long, no problem. I did do a little bit more tackle organizing. I went through my day pack and had kind of retired some of the things that were more focused. Like, I'm not carrying any frogs anymore in that box. I brought out, like, you know, blade baits and filled it with a variety of different jerk baits and things that I'm like cold weather temperatures. But like the main focus for me has been Ned rigs and hair jigs. It's been a big one. Hair jigs is a new sort of territory for me, something I've kind of always wanted to play with, but definitely Ned Riggs. It's good stuff. But what else did I do this week? Did anybody else go out this week and get on them? Like, you know, I wish I would have even had any bites. I would have been more than happy to parlay that info over to the fishing report this week. That would have been nice.
Yeah, that that picture, that not the non G-rated, the G-rated pictures that Tim put up on his Instagram.
Yep.
He had one of those smallmouth he caught today was over 21 inches.
It was a giant.
The mouth was open. It was over 22, but I say 21. It was 21, definitely. That was a pig of a fish.
That was a giant. Nice job, Tim. Yeah. Nice job, Tim. You know what? Yeah. And, you know, it's not unlike, this is not like a rare thing that we'll get, you know, picks from Tim just slaying them, slaying smallies specifically in the cold weather. Like, this is something that's kind of a regular routine. And I kind of think that he's like, hey, guys, look what I can do. I did this. Teddy Forget jumps in, says, what's going on, fellas? You know, we're here. We're putting together, we're creating podcast greatness, or at least trying, goddammit.
Hello, Teddy, and welcome back. We haven't heard from him for a little
while. It has been a bit. He's gone silent
for a little bit. I'm sure he's busy. Apparently, judging by his icon there, he's now sponsored by Nike. Congrats.
Look at that. Congratulations. I didn't even know that they were getting into the fishing world, but hey, good for them, you know?
No, they haven't. Teddy's gotten into the footwear
game. Teddy's gotten into the footwear game.
Keep an eye out for your Air Forgets.
He is a your Air Forgets, dude.
Sorry, Teddy.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, this is good stuff. Ryan Bogley jumps in here, says, saw some guys fishing the pond in Central Park in New York City this weekend, and I had some Jigs and Bigs stickers in my laptop briefcase, and I let them know what's up. Dude, that is awesome, man. We appreciate that. Seriously, that's one thing that I try to do more than anything. Like, that's why I try to always make sure I have a couple of stickers on me wherever I'm going out. And speaking of this kind of plays into something that we had just sort of happen over this yesterday, actually. So my family and I, I'll get to our activities, our family activities in just a minute. But my family and I made a decision to support a local business, a wonderful little Italian market, a little deli. They make amazing sandwiches and salads and all kinds of great stuff. Frigo's Market. So we decided we were going to order dinner from Frigo's Market. My wife says, what do we want to do for dinner? My youngest daughter was at a sleepover. My oldest daughter was like, how about sandwiches? And we're like, okay, well, it sounds like a good idea. Maybe we'll figure this out. And then ultimately what we ended up doing is going on a ride to just kind of tool around and look at Christmas lights. More on that later. And we ended up picking up dinner at Frigo's. And I mean, not only was the sandwich amazing, but they make their own. Like, I know, Sean, you're a chips and a soda guy.
Whoa. There's been some news. There's some news here. I had a doctor's appointment. And part of getting old is tell you can't do things that you like to do anymore.
Yeah. They love to tell
you
that.
If you'd like to continue, A, living, and B, being pain-free. For the first time, and not even in my adult life, I cannot remember not having a soda for this long. I just hit like a month. I quit soda.
That's not the worst thing, man. I enjoy a soft drink once in a while. I have found that throwing down seltzer has been my go-to, and not that White Claw crap or whatever. No. I'm talking about just like a little, you know, there was a joke in the early 2000s. I used to have a guy from Houston, Texas that was managing my department back at the TV station. And one of these guys came in, and he's an old Navy guy. And he would come in, and one of my coworkers was drinking like a bottle of flavored water or something. He's like, what are you doing? What's that? And he went off the rails. He was like, what are you doing drinking flavored water? Then there was a bunch of speech that came out that was not 2021 compliant. and we don't see Dave anymore. But
nice.
It was a little interesting. But yeah, I think especially Polar, non-sponse, by the way. I would gladly take a check, Polar. But local business, I love Polar Seltzer. It's a great alternative. But my question is, Sean, is the occasional chip or crisp still in the realm?
Occasional. They're fucking mandatory. I still do the chips. That's why I'm such a lard ass.
Okay. Yeah. That's one of the things that Frigo's does, is their own in-house chips. They come in this like clear bag. Yeah, absolutely. And like, I mean, you know, when we had them, like we finished our ride and we ate later. If you have them like fresh right there, I'm sure that it's just like melt your face delicious, like out of this world. Fish in the Stick says, Dave's not here, man. It's true. He's not. He's not. He's at Human Resources. That's where Dave is. And then Loaded Potato says, I don't drink water. Fish fucking it. They do. They do.
True statement.
Whales do as well. And that's why the ocean is salty.
Totally off topic, but kind of in line with a whale comment.
Yeah.
Did you know? This was in the news recently. Did you know that whale shit is apparently valuable?
Really? Why? Like, is it a resource? Like
if you're in a fishing boat or some shit and you come across a big giant floating pile of whale shit and you find that, you are not fishing that day. You are bringing that in.
You're harvesting whale poop.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, why?
I don't know what the reason is.
Really?
I got through the article and I was like, I don't remember why.
I'm confused. Yeah.
Apparently, whale shit has something in it that is incredibly valuable. I don't know what.
Dreams.
There you go.
It's full of dreams.
Everyone go ahead and fucking research whale shit now. I'm not going to. I don't care. I'm just dangling that carrot. You guys enjoy.
No, it's fair. I respect that and I applaud. I actually applaud that.
You applaud that or whale or are you applauding me or the whale shit or both?
Let's just kind of say I walk the line. I'm like the man in black here. I'm walking the line. So anyway, back to Frigo's, okay? I had a dirty Italian, which is amazing, absolutely delicious, chock full of hot peppers and all kinds of great, like fresh ingredients, amazing cold cuts, like super high quality. But what's amazing is this. I go walking in and we had called the order in and I was just going in to pick it up and everything was all set. And I go in and there's a young gentleman behind the counter says, how can I help you? I said, oh, I'm here for a pickup order. He says, oh, okay, what's the name? And I tell him my name and he goes over. He's like, oh, I like your jacket, man. And I was wearing this jacket here, the Jigs and Bigs one. He's like, I like your jacket, man. That's awesome. He's like, you fish a little bit? And I was like, yeah, I fish a little bit. And I said, actually, I go, this jacket is, this is the logo for the fishing podcast I operate locally. And he's like, oh, no kidding, man. I'll have to check it out. So I didn't have any stickers on me. And I had to, if I was alone, I would have been like, sit tight. I would have ran out to the car, dug in my tackle bag until I grabbed some, come back and hooked him up. I'm going to stop by and leave a stack of stickers for this young gentleman because I appreciate it. His mother was actually working in the grocery section and they had to substitute a couple items because they were out. So they worked all that stuff out. And she goes, you know, he's a really big fisherman. He'd love your show. And I was like, he should probably listen to it when you're not around. I'm just saying, like, you should probably give it a listen when you're not around. But he took a picture of the logo and he's like, I'm going to check it out. It's on Spotify and Apple Podcasts and everything. I was like, it's on all of them. Check it out. Absolutely. So I didn't get his name. I'm going to pop back in there for a bag of chips and another dirty Italian and to drop off some stickers. And I will get his name and hook him up with some Jigs and Big swag. So hopefully we have a new listener. I love when we get new listeners. Like, to me, that's amazing. Like, I know I mentioned this to you before. Like, it's amazing this relationship that we build with our listening audience. Like, and I mean, in the best situation, it's like with absolutely total strangers. You know what I mean? Just folks that organically start listening to the show, we get in contact with through like Instagram comments or DMs or something. It happened with Albert Rock. He ended up on the show, you know? I mean, same thing with George Costa, same exact situation. In fact, I think with George, he was one of them who actually had started at the beginning. Albert's been listening for so long. For him, he was just catching on, I think. But for George, he was a number of episodes behind and went and caught up. I got a DM this week from a new listener in New Hampshire who had shot me an email, Anthony Bedard. He shot me a DM, I should say, and we got to talking. He and I are going to make some some plans to fish this spring, and he wants to learn a little bit more about jigs. I told him I will try my damnedest to teach him what I know about jigs, and we'll figure that out. So, plus, you know, I love just getting around and, like, you know, doing a bank's end somewhere, and when I can, you know, meet new people, I'm all about that kind of shit. I'm 100% in.
You and I are social fucking butterflies.
We really are, man. Really, and like when you can talk, you know, fishing, and, you know, like, engage with people that are like, they dig your the stuff that you do. Like, I got to be honest with you guys. Oh, I joke a lot, but I am, like, legitimately floored that, first off, there is anybody watching this live. Second off, that there is anybody who would pay for this to like get this link to watch it live. Third, out of all the people who listen to this show every day, we've been doing this now. This is like show number 90. Like,
oh. Hold on. Let me get verification on that. This is, no, we're close. 88.
This is 88. I thought we already did 88.
No, sir.
Really? Okay.
88.
Well, all right. So this is 88 out of 88. This has been 88 weeks. I'm still as floored that anybody listens to this piece of shit, like, at all. Like, I'm still floored. It blows my mind. I thought we did 88.
Maybe. I might have fucked up here.
You know what one thing they really like to do these days? Recount.
You know what? Yeah, I think we're on 91. You know
91.
Why?
Because holy shit. We're on episode Interstate 91.
Stand by.
You guys are awesome. Fishing in the Sticks is best fishing show for me. Keep it up. I appreciate it, man. And that's the thing. That's the beauty about this show, is that we're doing it to kind of entertain ourselves. And we know that there is an audience that likes what we do. So, you know, that's the thing. We're not trying to impress anybody. You know, that's the whole thing. That's the whole deal. Like, we're just trying to, like, do what we do and have it be organic and talk some fishing and get some shit going. All kinds of good stuff. As far as the rest of my week, it was pretty much like behind the scenes stuff. I did a ton with a couple of things. First off, we've got details coming about the live show, the 100th show happening on February the 5th. More tickets have been selling. We've been talking with a bunch of different folks for different ways to kind of build value a little bit. We had a really, really great meeting early in the week. I think it was either Tuesday or Wednesday, and it was a good meeting. Came up with a great plan. We have a nice skeleton for a show. So I think we have something that you guys are really going to enjoy. Something that I think that you're not going to regret, you know, showing up to this event and even buying tickets. I think you're going to get way more out of this than, should I maybe just like give people a peek of like what we've got lined up?
Sure.
Maybe just a peek.
I'm done with it.
So here's what we're working on, guys. We have a what we're calling a virtual vendor card that's going to be lined up. Every attendee is basically going to receive a packet. And in there, we're going to have some supporters of the show that are, you know, contributing and, you know, putting together some special stuff. There's going to be, you know, stickers and things like that we can get from companies we've worked with in the past. And new companies. And that's one of the things we're trying to do is to build our relationships more and more and more in different ways. I don't want to get into any of the details of who those folks are. You guys are going to know. In fact, one of them I made a mention is already making an appearance. And if you were paying attention on Instagram, you would have caught on. We have a couple of things that are lined up, though. First and foremost, so this packet you'll receive, it's going to be one at every seat, and each one will be individually numbered. What we're going to do is this. We're going to raffle off. We're basically going to choose numbers at random. Those numbers are going to play as contestants. We're going to play a little bit of a deal or no deal style game show. We've got great prizes up for grabs that run a gamut of different value levels. And we have some zonks in there, too, to keep it nice and fun as well. And we're going to fill that board up. There are 14 different slots of like great things that you guys can win. And we've got this lined up. We're planning. This is going to happen in our third segment of the show. Following our Ask Me Anything, we're going to do an interview segment with a couple special guests. I'm not going to even announce who they are until later. And what we're going to do is put together this awesome live experience, and then we're going to give away a bunch of really cool prizes in a fun sort of way and have a great time doing it. Put some pressure on some folks, and you guys will actually get to see what it is that I do. You know what I mean? For my job. This is like, you know, this is going to be a lot of fun. There's going to be a lot of surprises. Go ahead.
Yep. And of course, you are referring to our 100th episode recording live at Nathan Bill's on February 5th.
Absolutely.
Just so everyone's good.
Yeah. Yep. Cool. February the 5th. It's going to be cold, but it's going to be amazing. It's going to be amazing. We got a couple of comments coming in here. Ryan jumps in, says, this is the Butcher's first live. Sean, let me hear it.
Butcher.
Wow. Well, that's a December 5th. The Butcher.
That's my post booster shot Butcher. Yeah.
We are 60 days out from the live event. 60 days.
Let me see if I can muster one up.
Debuting on Jigs and Bigs December 5th. Weight unknown from Pots Unknown. Butcher.
I love it, dude. I love it. Loaded Potato jumps in. Says, Sean doesn't count the shows he wasn't on. That's only like 3 or 4. Although, actually, I think the math adds up. You don't know that I think about it.
Well, no, I don't know what's going on with that sheet. I don't think I've just been saving the same line over and over again for 3 weeks. All our previous episodes are on there. I'll have to go.
We'll figure it out. Yeah, that's not. We don't have to worry about it right now.
No, at this point, no matter what, February 5th is our 100th show.
It's true. Yeah. I mean, we've done the math based on the start of the show. So I know that's accurate. So we're good. But man, it's going to be so good. We do have a couple of special guests that we're going to have on for this AMA. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. We have some partners that they've worked with that we're looking to get some cool prizes with. We have some folks that are already confirmed. So we've got great stuff lined up, and it's going to be a ton of fun. Make Massachusetts Fishing Spots great again. Is the benefactor of this, because the ticket money goes to them, as well as, you know, the donations and stuff from the partners that we're working with, because we're taking donations from all of them as well. So we're adding that to the money that we've raised from the tournaments, and we're presenting a giant check for them that night. It's going to be awesome. Going to be really exciting. So, and if you're local, I mean, even if you don't like fishing, but if you just don't hate the environment, you really should go check this show out. You really should. Like,
the environment.
If you're not like pave the rainforest or pave, you know, Quabbin, you know, or something like that. I mean, just to put it in like our local terms, you should come and check this out. This is going to be a good thing, and you'll 100% enjoy it.
That pave Quabbin movement's got a lot pave of support.
They're rallying. You know, they're getting there. They're getting there. So, you know, we got, you know, Frigos. I got to make another stop there. I will not be disappointed. And that says a lot, man, because I'm a Pagers guy. Like Pagers and Agawam. Mm-hmm. That's like my sandwich spot right there. Although you get a sandwich from them and you're eating all week long. Pretty much.
Which isn't necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah, no, it's not a bad thing. Yeah. What else do we have going up here? We have, I mean, all kinds of stuff that you guys are going to love. February is going to be amazing. Of course, there's talk about some fishing expos we're hoping to make an appearance at. So that is coming up. It's just that season, you know? And then, of course, we're looking forward to getting out on the hard water and eating some chorizo, because you know that's really the winter focus right now.
There are rules.
There are rules. Sausages will be consumed.
Yes, and So, speaking of the season,
yeah,
it's Christmas season, the holiday season.
Oh, it is.
I'd like to hear a little story about family activity.
Oh, okay. Yeah, the family activities. So I can't be the only one who thinks or uses this opportunity in this way. My children, since they were super young, babies, have always been thoroughly entertained with Christmas lights, you know, and it is kind of a long-standing roast beef family tradition where we will gather in the car. Usually we'll go and grab some warm beverages, some hot cocoa for the kids, maybe a coffee for Mama Beef and myself, and we'll take a drive. And when they were young, it was nice and easy. We would just go and do like the Bright Nights thing, or in for those that are local in the area, Look Park has a great display of lights. I highly recommend you go check it out. But oftentimes what we'll do is like, my wife and I really enjoy like the houses, the specific residences, you know, and especially when you go down into a neighborhood where maybe the neighbors compete with one another for like the craziest display. Like, we really enjoy that kind of stuff. But you see, we're awful human beings and we're raising terrible, terrible people. Awful, the worst, probably. We've made it a family tradition, and this goes back probably like at least the last 5 years, where we will drive around and basically hand out ratings of the quality of a holiday light display, no matter what it is. You know, we'll go by, and you know, some of them are really like, you know, they're very proper and nice, like lots of nice small white lights with some garland around a fence, the little candles in the windows, but we will shit all over them if there is anything out of place. God help you if my wife notices that you're using two different colors of white light, like a traditional soft and then a harsh white, like stark, like industrial, like, oh my goodness. If I see a projector that's just the lasers just shooting all over the front of your house, I've officially written you off as a trash human being, you know? And again, not that I'm any better. I am a piece of shit. I am a piece of shit. And my piece of shit wife and myself are raising pieces of shit. But we, you know, this is how we gather our holiday spirit. This is how we do it. It's how we raise each other up, by shitting on everything that's good in the world. And we live around the corner from a couple of homes that go like, you know how like you'll see like there's that house that people post on like social media. They're like, oh, go to this address, it's amazing. And you go, you tune in your radio to whatever, and there's a soundtrack and announcements. And sometimes I've even seen these really nice displays where they'll say, we're raising money for, you know, the Salvation Army, and such a text such and such to whatever to donate. And like, it's amazing. It's really great. And then you get these houses, and I have a picture. I've got to look for it. And they always seem to be the ones that go on first, like before anybody else ever possibly asked them to put up a holiday light. They're on first, and it is just entirely too early for some of that shit. Entirely too early. Oh, where is it? I'm going to find it. And you know what? I'm going to find it, and I'm going to post it on our Instagram. I'm going to find it, and I'll post it on our Instagram. These types of things, like, they have all the heart. But oh my God, we just shit all over them. We're terrible. I hope you guys don't think less of me. Or I actually hope I've inspired some of you to go out and do the same and enjoy and lift yourselves up in this holiday spirit, you know?
On the backs of others' hard work to decorate their houses.
Yeah. I'm convinced some of these homes don't ever take those lights down.
That's the way it used to be. I mean, if you had a giant light display, that shit was up all year because you weren't... You weren't going up and doing the Clark Griswold every year. Fuck that. That was a lot of work. People left that shit up.
You add to it, you never take it down. You know?
Correct.
I don't know. I mean, like, we do... And that said, like, we own it. Like, our lighting displays are terrible. This year, there's nothing up. Like, this year, we haven't done anything to it. Normally, they're god-awful. In fact, we're trying to retool, like, even what we're going to do for a Christmas tree, because we have one of the worst artificial trees I've ever seen. The lights are amazing on it. Lots of control. Fishing in the Sticks says, you made me laugh, but you made my wife laugh, Bobby. Apparently we're pieces of shit too. At least we can be pieces of shit together, you know? Like, that's all that matters. It's terrible. Oh, there's this one house, and I'm gonna. It's right around the corner from us. It's so like if all the streetlights were out, and there was nothing in the sky, it would light up the sky. It is so like out of this world bright. It is insane. But hey, it is what it is. You know, we all have a good time with it. So yeah, that's me, Sean. Do you guys have any interesting like holiday traditions or anything like that you guys do that are like a little odd?
No, pretty standard. We might go out and check out, like, for people who aren't in Western Massachusetts, in Springfield, there's the largest park in Springfield. I believe it's the largest. Am I off on that?
It is the largest park. Yeah. Yeah.
So is called Forest Park. Now, one half of Forest Park is just really nice old neighborhoods, old turn of the century, giant houses. Mm-hmm. The other side's the fucking hood. So there's this interesting dichotomy that meets at Forest Park, but they have a giant, like light up display where they put up everything. I mean, there are fucking dinosaurs and astronauts.
I'm glad Santa Claus, you went there.
You name it, and it's a big drive through. So you're in your car and you drive through that. We do that every now and again. Yep. We haven't done it yet this year. Our tradition and you know what? I didn't do it this year actually.
It's still early.
I didn't do it. No, I can't. It's a one shot deal. We go cut our tree down.
All right. Oh, okay.
And we've been going to the same tree place for years and years and years. Mm-hmm. The owner knows me. They're great, and they take care of us. So we'll go down. We'll go usually the weekend of Thanksgiving, cut our tree down,
mm-hmm.
and bring it into the house. But usually, like, we take a nice picture of the kids in front of the tree, and then I'm like a sadistic madman holding up the hacksaw behind them, like making crazy eyes and like screaming and shit.
Oh, okay.
And my wife's taking pictures, like I'm going to now cut my kids down.
There you go.
So yeah, that's pretty fun.
That's awesome.
We do that. I mean, really, you know, pre-Christmas wind up, that's it. Usually it's that weekend and the following week after Thanksgiving where we have our tree cut down and we go ahead and trim that bad boy. I keep minimal lighting. So if you want to drive, you know where I live, you want to drive by my house and have a fucking laugh and shit on me while you guys are having a coffee.
We've been around your neighborhood driving around and been like, what the fuck is this bullshit?
It's pretty pitiful. All I do is I've got a couple bushes outside front of the house and all I do is wrap a couple of them with lights and I'm like, wipe my hands of that. Fucking there's my effort.
See, I always say this. I always say less is way more. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, and doing it like the right way. I'll tell you what, one of the greatest things they ever invented for Christmas lights was that the net, you know what I'm saying? Where it's just a big grid of lights and you can just wrap it around a bush or a tree. Because the worst part is where, you know, you might have like, oh, this is a nice elm tree that's in our front yard or something like that. And you're like, oh, let's throw some lights in there. And when you plug them in and it's dark everywhere else, you literally get the impression somebody just took a string of lights and threw them at the tree. And you're like, I mean, I suppose it's festive. You know what I mean? I don't know. See, I grew up in one of these houses, you know, out in the country. We had 1, 2, 3, 4 windows in the front of our house. No, I take that back. We had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 windows in the front of our house. And we had those little battery-powered candles that went up there. And that was it. That was our... that was it. I'm like...
It's funny. You know what? When it comes to those, just to show how my life has just progressed and really hasn't progressed.
Yep.
One of my first hospital trips as a youngster was because my parents had those too, and I unscrewed one of the light bulbs and ate them when I was a baby.
Oh, when
I was like a toddler, yeah.
Wow, dude. Did it make it all the way down?
No idea. I don't want to ask my mom. I don't know. Hopefully, I either passed it or threw it up, or I have no idea. But I went to the hospital over that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's rough.
Like 2 years old.
We're like learning some shit.
I've eaten a lot of weird shit over the years.
Well. Yeah. Man, that is bananas. Yeah, so I did find that image. It's actually a video, but I can zoom in and it was rainy the day that I took the picture. I will take another picture this week and I'll post it because I go by this house all the time, but I'm going to put it up here. This is the house. So you guys can see, there is no rhyme or reason to what's going on there. Like, there is nothing at all. There's just a bunch of lights on every single wooden surface that is on that home. And we have a local utility department who I'm sure is pissed this time of year. Like, the dam can only do so much work. Jesus.
Jeez. Yeah, that's a shit show that guy's got going on.
Oh, it's good shit. It's good shit. You know what? I'm going to throw a call out there. If you're in Western Massachusetts and you know of a street where there is an absolute horror show of holiday lights, shoot me a DM. I want to know the streets and the towns. I want to go and start taking pictures of these places and featuring them. You know what I mean? Like, the little light display that could. Like, I want to know, what do you guys consider a shit show? Feel free to hit us up in the comments here while we're recording this live. We'll go ahead. But we have a couple of things that we're going to go over regarding that, you know, we have a lot going on for 2022 that isn't just the live show on the 5th of February. In fact, this week, Sean has been very hard at work putting together some of the intricate details, and I think there's going to be some really fun stuff. Maybe even a shakeup as far as our tournament preparations have gone. So this is exciting, Sean. What do you say?
Let me take this away.
Go
Let me
for
just
it.
Take this away. Let me hit you guys with some funny shit.
So, oh, it's funny.
How do I start? I guess, you know, I haven't fished in a couple of weeks. Okay. I've got my, my kayak is under repair right now. This is the time of year where there's minimal fishing anyways. The most I would be doing would be like a Cape Cod trip here and there, or somewhere out to the eastern part of the state where the ice is hopefully not as skim or existent as the western part. But, with all that you and I have been doing over the past couple of years between this show and all that goes along with it, with, mm-hmm. you know, while you are the audio engineer, par excellence, there's a lot of other stuff that I bring to the table with past jobs that, you know, particularly concerning like networking that I'll get into in a minute.
Yep.
That we have to do. We have to push forward with some of this stuff. Oh, and then yeah. on top of that, I'm directing what, 3 tournament trails.
Mm-hmm.
So between MAKB and the Chronic Trip stuff and the Jigs and Bigs stuff, I have responsibilities there that when you're just an angler partner, I say just. I don't mean to insult any of the anglers that are fishing with us, but when you're an angler fishing that, you don't have to worry about.
Yeah.
You're there, you show up at an event, you fish, you have a good time, and all the behind the scenes stuff gets started during this off season.
That's like, what I was going to say. Like all of that actually rests on the director to kind of go ahead and orchestrate to make sure that the experience is as good as it can be for the participants.
Correct. Correct.
You know,
there's a lot of,
it's only right.
Well, I wasn't looking to give myself a hand job, but
Merry you know, Christmas, it's just, buddy. Merry you Christmas. Know,
there's a lot of stuff that goes into that. So one of the things that I was working on this week was with the format of the Jigs and Bigs and the Chronic Trip tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody who's participated in them knows that when you look at Fishing Chaos, you can see all the categories, but you can't see a leaderboard. Now, yeah. The way we started doing it before we got involved with Fishing Chaos, I had to make an Excel sheet. So there was no transparency on that. You guys are trusting me to do the right thing and put the right scores in and mm-hmm. not fuck up because I'm an yeah. idiot. We know that. When we got involved with Fishing Chaos, I initially threw this idea out of them of what we were doing and said, can you do this? And they kind of could with their master angler program, but it wasn't the right fit. So I said, no problem. We had jumped on a Fishing Chaos rather late, I think in the spring, right? It was, we were up against a wall with them
yeah.
pretty good.
Yep.
And I said, no problem. I'll continue to do it this year. And the minute the off season hits, I'd like to talk with some of the software engineers and let's see if we can find some, if it's not exactly what I want, what can we do to make it as close to what we're doing and get the spirit of what yeah. we're doing of that multi-species experience. And I spent a good amount of time. I had a meeting with the Fishing Chaos folks this week with Thomas, one of their engineers. He's a great guy. I laid it out for him. We went back and forth. He explained to me he needed just a little bit of write-up on what exactly I was looking for.
Mm-hmm.
He got back to me and said, I think we can do that. And they're going to get back to me again with some finalization plans this week. So the Jigs and Bigs and the Chronic Trips might have a tweak to them this year. the side stuff on the jigs and bigs and the chronic trips, yes. Definitely on the jigs and bigs. You and I talked about it the other day. I'll go ahead and blow that up. Is that cool? Do we want to wait on this?
No. Let's go ahead and do that. Yeah, let's get the conversation started.
Yeah, so what we decided to do was, because I want everything transparent, up on the Fishing Chaos. When you log into Fishing Chaos, if there's any side pools or anything like that, any side prizes, I want everyone to be able to see it. So they have some features with Fishing Chaos that I can screw around with that'll show these little side pools. Well, what we're going to do is, for our tournaments in 2022, every week there will be a random weekly prize. When I say random, the prize isn't random. Well, the prize actually will be random.
Yeah, it will be random.
We've lined up a couple of sponsors that wanted to get involved in this, have some product out there that I'm not going to divulge right now.
Yeah, that'll be a surprise.
What we're going to do is, Bobby and I are going to have a little fun. We're going to have, what are we going to call the wheel? We need a snazzy name
for
the wheel.
We need a sexy name. We need a sexy name for the wheel.
So like we can record something with a bunch of us saying, you know, wheel of, you know, what, you know, like Wheel of Fortune, but we'll completely rip it off because we're hacks.
Yeah, I like that idea.
Wheel of Pisces.
Let's throw it out to the listeners to get some submissions. Yeah. I like that idea. Name. Yeah.
So anyways, these wheels are going to be involved. For our side prizes, the main tournament's going to go on. Same thing, you know, catch your single fish in a species. You're going to get points for those fish. If it's the biggest one, it's going to get more. But
she's a fucking American treasure, dude.
Thanks for derailing that, Ellie. So you want to say it or me?
I will. She said, "Wheel of Foreskin." A national really treasure.
Not really relevant, but we'll run with it. We're anyways. Going. Oh my God, that just threw me off. All right. So, the regular tournament's going to go on as planned. Yep. Champion and however many spots, shall we say, payout are going to be determined by number of anglers in.
Yeah.
But those four weekly prizes are going to be determined by species will be on the wheel of not foreskin. Thank you, Ellie. The wheel will determine the species. The wheel will then determine a slot limit. So this is where things get fun.
Yep.
So now it turns into you spin the wheel. We spin the wheel. We'll do some fun little some Instagram reels for it or something. We'll spin the wheel. We'll come up with a species. It might be trout. And then we're going to get that slot limit, 14 to 16 inch trout. And then it'll be the prize that's going to be, you know, up for grabs that week. We'll have four prizes. So we're going to have some fun with this. More details will come, but that's the general way we're going with that. And I'm meeting with, I have some other ideas for chronic trips, and I'm meeting with Seth this week to discuss those.
It's going
to
be good.
That was one part of my week where I was just working with Fishing Chaos, trying to get that going. Now the other part of my week was dealing with some of the companies that I asked to be a part of these events and other events, which I'm not going to get into now. The time will come, we'll announce them, but this is what I wanted to talk about this week's kind of hot topic.
Yeah.
With my last job when I was working veteran services in the employment area, in the employment arena, right? What you had to do as a part of your job was reach out to employers. Say, hey, I have veterans here that are looking for work, looking for an improvement in their life. And the employer says, okay, if you've got somebody, call me. Whether it's a high-paying job or an entry-level job, whatever. Not every veteran is coming out of service and just going right into the workforce, right?
Yeah.
Like whatever they did, there's change up. Some people want to change and start over.
Yeah.
It's the broadest spectrum imaginable of what type of person you get in and what kind of job they're looking for and what jobs are available. You're playing matchmaker. One of the important things is when you've got a veteran trusting you on one side, and on the other hand, you have a company that's trusting you to get a good worker. All right. Now it's a free service for both sides. Nobody's paying anything. But if you go to a company and one of the most expensive things a company devotes money to is their hiring process.
Mm-hmm.
So if you've vetted someone and you turn to that company and say, I vetted this guy, I think he'll be all right for you. And that person either doesn't show up for a fucking interview or does whatever. Here's who it hurts. It hurts the company because they've spaced out time for this, right? To do this stuff. They might have even started some paperwork.
Yep.
It hurts the veteran because that person wasn't getting a job. Mm-hmm. And this does happen. Like, you know, veterans are people too. I mean, it's very nice that somehow public sentiment has swung the way of every veteran's an angel. I love that. We do a good job out there when we're doing stuff, but sometimes sure. life happens.
Yeah.
And we're everybody's people. Like, shit happens. So, it hurts that veteran because they're not working. And then it hurts, you know, the intermediary. Did I
yeah.
say that right?
Yeah, yeah.
Credibility, meaning me, because I've reached out to this company and said, I got a good guy for you. And now I look yeah. like an asshole.
And if you have a relationship with that company, this could potentially sour that for future veterans. So it has an effect on other veterans too.
And that was the fourth group down the road.
Yep.
Maybe somebody comes in who's a perfect fit for one of those jobs and that company won't talk to me anymore.
Yeah.
Where I wanted to wrap this in is we have not only people within our Jigs and Bigs circle, including, you know, all of the hoodlums and the Old Glory and Three Bells families, like yep. everybody.
Oh right? yeah.
Everybody from that's in our circle. I mean, not everybody is working full time in the fishing industry.
Yeah.
Most people, this is a side gig from them. Maybe they're, you know, construction or public services or whatever. They're yep. doing all sorts of different shit.
Yeah.
And not everybody needs or has had a chance to develop that soft networking skill that is mm-hmm. incredibly valuable. When you can call up, either cold call a contact you have in the industry and say, I would like to do something and I need your help, and turn around and say, and this is what I can offer you. Now it's not free services anymore. Now you're trading goods or services yep. or talking about them on a podcast, something like that.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's very important that those skills that I had to learn during the course of that time, that I remember them. And if someone says, yeah, hey, we'll give you some product for a giveaway, or we'll give you some product for a side prize on a tournament,
yeah.
something like that, you know, don't ever burn them in any way, shape, or form. Yeah. Like, and another, you know, another aspect of that is if someone is looking for something and I act again as an intermediary and then something doesn't happen, I'm going to feel bad because now I've maybe extended, or introduced someone to another group
yep.
or another person and things don't work out. And now the matchmaker doesn't look good.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that aspect. I don't know how to instruct anybody who's doing all this. I mean, this goes for everybody. This goes for YouTubers. This goes for anybody who's got their own little fishing brand. You got to have something. You got to get something. You got to treat it like it's yeah. your, I mean, honestly, you got to treat any relationship you make in this industry like it's your husband or wife. You yeah. want to protect that relationship.
You got to nurture it. You know,
yeah,
you got to nurture
yeah,
it.
No, exactly. So I don't know how to tell people how to learn those skills. I think, you know, they're, it's an experience thing, right?
You make a really good point, Sean, with this, but I want to throw a counterpoint out there that I think complements it and puts it a little bit in the real world scenario. Not every relationship you make networking is a positive one. Sometimes you end up, you have a relationship where you, you know, maybe you've networked, you've worked together on some projects and things are great. Then suddenly you start to realize that there's just sort of this expected, you sort of get taken for granted. So it's a good idea to, you know, pay attention to the type of relationships you've got that you're working on. Nurture the ones where it's mutual and you're helping one another. But yep. at the same time, you can't like get your resources so short that you are now you're doing, you know, you're lending, you know, some support to a brand or to, you know, whoever, an employee, you know, sometimes you got to know when to cut the dead weight, you know?
Yes. Check this out. Here's a good example.
Hit me.
This is a good analogy example. So you and I, I was going to get gross with this. I still think I will. Never mind.
Go
just
for it.
Me. I'm dating Esmeralda, the Gypsy Queen.
Okay.
Esmeralda sells crystal balls, right?
She's in the ball biz. Okay.
She's in the ball biz. I happen to know somebody who's looking for crystal balls. I introduce Esmeralda to these ball seekers.
We'll call
I can't not be 5 years old.
I know.
I've introduced Esmeralda to the Ball Seekers. And then the Ball Seekers call me up a month later and say, hey, what the fuck is going on with Esmeralda's balls? They're fucking shitty. And I say, I don't know. I got a ball from Esmeralda and they were great.
Yeah.
And then they say, well, Esmeralda's also fucking around with her balls and doing this and doing that. Now I'm in a pickle. Now I've got the Ball Seekers, who I was good with. Now Esmeralda's selling some fucking
shitty balls.
Fucking
shitty balls.
Shitty balls.
Non-QC'd balls.
Now my business might be at risk because me and Esmeralda aren't going to see eye to eye. I mean, like, yep. These are the things, like, you have to keep an eye on and constantly nurture and constantly communicate with all parties involved. And it just sucks. But it's part of doing all of this. Like, it's not just going out fishing, catching a bunch of big bass and turning around and saying, I need a sponsor.
Yeah.
Okay. What the
you got to do. You got to be able to pony up with, like, there's visibility, you know, like that's what it's all about. While we're on the subject of balls, something else happened this weekend that I'd like to call attention to. And it's that, I'm going to go ahead and do it. I'm going to pat old fat boy here on the back because, this week, there's a YouTube channel called The Try Guys. Very popular. Try Guys. They used to work for BuzzFeed, put out a bunch of videos and like they do like lots of food stuff, but like they're very LA, you know what I mean? Like it is what it is. Anyway, my kids love this stuff. I find it very entertaining. My wife finds it very, very entertaining. And they have a series called Without a Recipe, which I think could actually be kind of fun. And I'd like to rip some of that off. So they'll take something. They'll say like, oh, the Try Guys bake bread without a recipe. The Try Guys do this without a recipe. And they have a panel of judges that sit there that are in that specific like region. Either they're a presence on YouTube or, you know, let's say well, this last episode is macaroni and cheese. So the Try Guys make macaroni and cheese without a recipe. Big deal. One of the guys, Eugene, made giant, I mean, almost the size of my head, fried macaroni and cheese balls.
Oh, okay? My God.
Yeah. Except, see, the thing is with Eugene is Eugene has a dark side, and he made his with Rocky Mountain oysters.
Oh, in there. That ruins mac and cheese.
Well, here's the thing, and this is where I feel like your boy, BRB, needs a little pat on the back. Because I'm watching the video as he's doing the prep and everything, and what he did was he took these bull testicles and he basically cut them up into like little nuggets, just like I did. But then I think he just sauteed them, and then he added them to the mac and cheese. And what was funny was that everybody was diving into these giant balls of balls and mowing them down, and he told them what was in there. It's not like he blindsided anybody. They're like, oh, no, there's balls in there. Yeah, very matter of factly. Oh, there's 100% balls in there. So they're eating these things, and they were all like, you know what? I can taste them. Like, it tastes like balls. Like, I can taste them. Now, when I fried up those Rocky Mountain oysters, it was a delightful situation, I think, for every single. What do we have there? Like 30 people, and 29 of them ate the balls.
I didn't do a count on the ball eaters.
I know that there was all but one ate the balls. Everybody else had the balls. Either they took a Rocky Mountain oyster, they put it on a slice of pizza. I did that. It was delicious. But like I feel pretty good about that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like I feel pretty, and that was without a recipe. That was me just like making it up.
Yeah.
So I feel pretty good. So hang on. Fuck off, Eugene. I thought that was kind of interesting. But anyway, to get back on track here, you make a very valid point. That's a great that's a really, really great example. Like, you know, when you have a relationship with somebody and it's going well, you know, and they're creating something or doing something or making content, whatever it might be, and then you're trying to, like, you know, somebody, you connect the dots for them, it can put you in a rocky situation.
Yeah, so you got to be very, very careful with that stuff.
Nurture
that learning
shit.
It's learning those soft skills. Like a lot of, I mean, I can't tell you how many people over the years I worked with when I was doing, you know, aircraft maintenance.
Yeah.
Like people, there's a lot, there's a big section of the population out there when they want to do work, it's simply, I want to go work on something that's not going to talk to me. And they miss out on those, that opportunity to develop those soft skills. So like, you know, if you turn around and you're like trying to make your own brand with its fishing, whether it's apparel, whether it's, you know, social media, whatever.
It could be a food truck.
Everything, you know, anything you want to have those soft skills so that when you meet with someone and you want to either collaborate with them or do something, you have to be able to know how to talk to them, assess it, be straightforward, read them. You have to read what they want. Like it's soft people skills. I don't know how else to describe it, but that's the basis of your networking. And that's how you're going to get places and grow your business, social efforts, media, empire, whatever. Yeah. Whatever you're doing, your project.
Mm-hmm.
So keep that in mind. You know, with all the work I did and all the phone calls I made this week, it was on the tip of my tongue. So I figured I'd just kind of pass that along as a nice, we could have put this in just a tip, but we're following up on our part two of tackle storage and kayaks.
Yeah, absolutely. So if anything, you're getting two tips this week. So you're welcome.
For God's sakes, get tested.
Get tested. God damn it. Ellie chimes in and she says, if you're a dude eating balls, does that make you a cannibal? Slaps knee again. That's what we're going to call it from now on.
For context, we should probably let everyone know what Ellie let us know that she was doing right before she came here in the chat. Yeah, she downed a couple scorpion bowls somewhere.
More Western Mass classics, actually.
Possibly in an alley. We don't know.
She's out there in the old parking lot of Hooky Lao drinking scorpion bowls. Yeah, we actually have some really good stuff coming up. We have been real busy this week. Like, I just went through, and here's a little bonus, like, tidbit for you guys. We started reaching out, like I said, for some of these connections for prizes and things for the event at Nathan Bill's happening on February the 5th. And it's funny, I have a note on my phone that's just a living document where everybody I've talked to, I have a status of where it's been. If I just sent a message, if I heard anything back, how did I reply? All of that stuff. And I just constantly updating it until I have somebody confirm and say, yes, we want in, this is what we're going to do. Then boom, that's the way it works. We have, you know, a few people confirmed already, but it's basically what it is just like, dot your I's and cross your T's. Mm-hmm. It goes so far, you know,
and like write checks that your ass can cash.
Yeah. Exactly.
That's really it. Don't extend yourself and do this stuff and tell somebody one thing and not be able to come through. It's
yeah.
You know, it's a dangerous world out there. We want everybody we know to succeed. And,
it's,
you know,
true.
Chances are, though, it's for one reason or another, not everybody's going to, but that's all I could say. What is Ellie saying now?
She's saying, she goes, this has to be in context to the Scorpion Bowl discussion. She says she loves the long straws.
I bet.
Yeah, does. Yeah, it's good stuff. Good.
She tees them up for us. Thank you,
Ellie. She really does. Like, I'm telling you, when we're going to be dangerous when we get a studio, you know? We really are. Let's go ahead. I know what we got to talk about here. We have a couple of things going on. Sean filled me in on the details of how ridiculously close he is to hitting that 1,000 mark. It's like, and it's awesome. So thank you, guys. We appreciate you. The Sean the Fisherman Instagram is teetering right on the edge. The Jigs and Bigs Instagram has been floating in this one section. We are, as of just before I started hitting record, we're at 11 follows away. We get 11 follows, we're doing a giveaway. So it very well can happen this week. We've got stuff for you from great, great participants that are working with us, putting some really, really great stuff together for you guys. So we're very, very, very close. The Bobby Roast Beef account, we've got some time. Got like hundreds and hundreds of people. But, I mean, we're really close on both of those accounts, and that would be freaking awesome. You know what would be cool is if we could fire both of them off, like one right after the other.
Yeah, I think the Sean the Fisherman one's like just over 100 away. So we're close, but not anywhere as near as close as the Jigs and Bigs one. That one's ready to fucking pop.
Fisherman in the Sticks says 1290 forever. 12,900 forever. I got to tell you, like, I've been watching it and I'm like, we go up a little bit. We're going up. There's a couple more. We're making a few more. And I'm like, man, I can't wait. I can't wait. I love giveaways. I love giveaways. I love giving away prizes. It's such a good thing. So we got that. That's coming up. We have, let's see. Oh, yeah. So as far as giveaways, that's where that goes. Of course, as a reminder, if you guys want to get your Jigs and Bigs merch, you can go ahead and do so at jigsandbigs.com. The brand new store is up. You can check that. I say brand new. It's been months. It's been up. But go check it out. And we're working with the good folks over at Mantis Graphics. They do a great job. Their quality control is amazing. I actually would love to get this jacket on the website soon because this is nice. Like today was like about 40-45 degrees. I had a meeting with a bride and groom for an upcoming event next year, and I met with them today and I was like, oh yeah, it's a nice, you know, little jacket. No one need anything too crazy on today. It won't be freezing my ass off, and this is perfect. Absolutely perfect. So, you know, you can get your merch there. Thursday, we had another amazing fishing report from Cheryl. Drop that, northeastwildwoman.com. Appreciate you very much, Cheryl. I am going to hustle over the next 2 weeks to really try to get out there and like wrap my head around some conditions, and hopefully I'll be able to contribute something to that report, because if I don't, it's going to end up being 2022 when it's going down, but it's got to happen.
I've got to thank you, Ryan, Tim. You guys have been getting out and still fishing. And I mean, Tim has just been fucking killing it. That smallmouth he caught today, holy shit. And the shirtless picture he sent, holy shit.
That was amazing. That was amazing. Yeah. Almost as amazing. Like, I mean, it's one thing that we get these amazing photos sent to us, but we also, Ellie just chimed in with this one. She goes, when you reach 15K, I will launch my OnlyFans and eat cheesecake from my hot dog suit.
I don't know what that means, but I'm sure there's a whole segment of the population out there that will buy that regularly.
You heard it here, folks. That's what I'm saying. You know, maybe we'll put a little hot link there. Membership's available at jigsandbigs.com. No. There's value there. What if there's one thing that we've learned from Ellie, that there is value there. Wait, don't you put that on Insta. You can start a Patreon if you want. But oh, my goodness.
Well, that derailed everything.
It really did. It really did. My God. The final thing that we want to mention, of course, is that we have that Spotify playlist that's available. You guys can check out Spotify or Jigs and Bigs Volume 2, just a bunch of random songs. I got to go and take another gander at that and throw some new stuff on there. We do have this was a big week for Spotify, by the way. Can I just throw that out there? Like a huge week for Spotify. This was the week that Spotify Wrapped was released. I think it was Wednesday. It was either Tuesday or Wednesday. I had gone and picked up my my oldest daughter at school. And she says, hey, she's like, did you check your Spotify Wrapped yet? And I was like, no, I didn't know it was out. So I opened up my app and sure enough, there it was. But Spotify Wrapped was kind of cool. I mean, I'm gonna go ahead and flex a little bit here with this, guys. I took a couple of screenshots of mine so that I could keep these numbers together. But it says that we've had some impressive growth this year. Here's what we can't wait for what you do next. As far as hours listened, we have grown by 526% as far as the number of hours listened in the last year. As far as streams are up 380%. Followers up 162%. And that is only on the Spotify platform, which is our number two platform, by the way. Our listeners are up in total of 61% on Spotify. Very, very exciting to get that information. Come to find out that over a third of our fans listen, and I hate that word fans, but they used it. They said fans. Over a third of our listeners listen between the hours of 11 a.m. and 5 p.m., making it the most popular time. That's awesome. I'm assuming that, you know, adjusts for everybody's time zone and everything. And this is amazing, Sean. Mm. In the last year, we released 45 episodes. Take a guess at how many minutes of content that was.
We can't stop talking.
Yep.
What'd you say? How many episodes?
45.
I'm going to say...
Let me see. Carry the eight.
Carry the friggin' eight.
I'm gonna say, give or take 300. How about that?
Give or take
300.
Yeah, we'll say give or take 300.
8,200 minutes.
No, 6,829.
I was off. Yeah. I overestimated. So I thought we could talk more than we actually did.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because some of our episodes, like from, you look back like a year, we're like hitting the 90 minute mark pretty routinely. And then we did have some that were like well over 3 hours. Fishing in the Six jumped in. He says, I'm on Google. Yeah, we do. Google has a small share of our listening audience right there. He says, Spotify pisses him off. It's okay. It's all right. It's not for everybody. You know, it's funny. There was a meme I saw. It was that bus meme where there's two different characters, one on one side of the bus looking out the window all happy, and the other one sitting there with his legs up on the chair, like all sad and depressed. And on the happy side, it said Spotify users, and on the sad side, it said Apple Music listeners.
Yes.
And I'm like, you know, it's because I don't think Apple does anything like that, which is kind of interesting because I know there's plenty of people that use it. You know, I know it. It, you know, it is what it is. And then there's the whole discussion about like Spotify and the music industry and everything else. Like, I've got a whole stack of opinions there. I don't think anybody should be boycotting any of this stuff, but I do think that these companies need to start paying artists like reasonably. I think it's ridiculous. Even, you know, as somebody that has a premium membership, and I would, if that doubled or tripled, it would still be worth it for the amount of use I get out of it.
And podcasters too.
And podcasters. Yeah, but that content's free.
I know.
You know what I mean? It's a different kind of animal. That's different. It is all, Ellie says she's an Apple sheeple. It's okay. You know, it's all good. Oh, yeah. See, Fishing with the Sticks says he just doesn't like the ads. I totally get it. Like, I think the ads are horseshit too. I spend for Spotify, I think I drop like $15 a month, but all the members of my family have paid accounts. They don't get any commercials, nothing like that. They can create music, they can, you know, do playlists, do downloads, the whole nine yards. I mean, when I say downloads, like, they got to play them in Spotify. It's not like they're files, but there's a bunch of stuff in there. And I'm like, when I think of, like, because I still buy music, I mean, I'm a freaking DJ, like, I still purchase music that I'm not really into sometimes, you know? Yeah. So, like, there's money going out there. But when you look at, like, think about back in the 90s, man, how much we would spend on CDs. Easily drop $15, $17 for one disc.
They're still close to that. They're still, like, $12, $13.
Oh, they are. But that would be...
But new, but I buy used.
Yeah.
And I listen to music digitally, so everyone doesn't think I'm some sort of raging, aging boomer. I'm not. We're the tail end of Gen X. But I still buy CDs because I like having a hard copy, and I still like listening to an entire album, CD, whatever, front to back.
Yeah.
That's me. But I do listen to, you know, if I'm in the car, I listen to Spotify.
Yeah.
Because there's no more CD players in cars.
Well, when there's I'm at that home, too. Yeah.
I do like to deep listen. I'll put on some, you know, I'll put on a disc I haven't listened to start to finish and lie on the couch and just listen to that. I do that regularly.
And the thing is that, like, I don't even know how I got started on this. There was somebody posted something on YouTube or on Facebook posted something on Facebook about, like, oh, all these Spotify listeners are basically, like, outing themselves as not, you know, supporting the music industry. And I'm like, you know, man, In a way, like, the consumer's hands are a little bit tied because the technology is changing, and it sucks that it's not paying the artist the way that it should. Something should happen with that, you know? But it is what it is. Like, I get what this guy was doing. He's a pissed off musician, you know, which I get it, but, you know, what can you do? Ellie chimes in and asks a big question. She says, are we doing a New Year's Best of 21 special edition B&J's show? That's another show. And not on New Year's Eve. We won't be doing a look back, but we will be having a look back show. That'll be coming up. We have a lot of content to go through, almost 7,000 minutes of material. So we got some stuff we got to go through, make some lists. But yeah, that will be coming. I think maybe what we'll do is when we do that, we might bring on some special guests onto this whole platform and kind of have some fun with it. You know, if we do that, if we do that, I think what we should do is maybe meet where we get some real reliable internet and record it there and use some video clips and things like that from, you know, stuff that comes in and, you know, it'll be all good.
We got options.
Yeah, we got options. I love that. So I think that about does it, guys. Also, one final thing I do. Oh, wait, hold on a second. Was there something else that you wanted to mention there, Sean?
We did our shout outs, right?
Yep.
Hold on. Let's see here. Yes, I did have one thing. You know what? I'll throw it in just a tip.
We'll throw it in at just the tip. Very nice.
Yep.
All right, cool. I think that about does it, guys, for this first segment of Jigs and Bigs. We'll be back. We got round number two coming. We got a brand new FTG. Gets a little bit weird. You know, we'll explain. Yeah, we'll explain. Don't go too far, guys. We got much more show coming up right after this quick message. Jigs and Bigs is proud to announce we're being supported by Old Glory Outdoors. They're a veteran-owned company that carries fishing and hunting gear. Plus, they're highly active in supporting veteran organizations and charities. Old Glory is an authorized dealer of Favorite Rods, FX Rods, Guggen Baits, X-Zone Lures, Sixth Sense, and many more. There's a brick-and-mortar store located in East Brookfield, Massachusetts, but you can also order online at oldgloryoutdoors.com. They ship anywhere in the lower 48 states or order online and pick up at the store. When you order, use the promo code Jigs and Bigs and you'll save 10% off your complete order. Plus, you'll help support the show. Make sure to check out the apparel line called OGO Gear while you're there. Old Glory Outdoors believes in the slogan "Start 'em Young" to keep kids away from screens and enjoying nature. They've got a full array of live bait too. Check out oldgloryoutdoors.com and use the promo code Jigs and Bigs. Save some money and gear up now.
Bobby and Sean now have a special presentation for us all. They'd like to give everyone just the tip.
Well, it is a brand new segment, a brand new week. Oh, look, we have Lauren joining us. Hi, how you doing, Lauren? We have some good stuff to talk about this week. We're going to continue that conversation we started last week about tackle storage and strategies and all that stuff. And Sean is going to take us for a walk through his vessel.
Very, very simple with tackle storage. For me, I am a cheap ass.
Yep.
We've discussed this a million times as far as my tackle goes, as far as wanting to carry the minimal amount of tackle that will keep me competitive in tournaments that I'm in. And I like keeping a light boat. I don't like, you know, I've paddled and pedaled boats, and I understand that you really go out of control with gear and it just makes it harder on yourself. I'm not doing that shit. I'm too old for that shit. So in my boat currently, I have one of those, oh, God damn it. It's a tackle crate that it has one of those like canvas waterproof bags around it. I forget the brand. Is it, it's Feel Free. I actually won it at the Three Bells Trifecta raffle.
Yeah.
I bought some raffle tickets real late and just threw those in and got the tackle bag, and it's a crate. And at first I was a little hesitant to use it because I've been using a file crate for years.
Yeah.
A file crate that I got from Staples for like $2.
Yep.
And that fit the boxes, the number of waterproof boxes that I was carrying perfectly. And I'm like, I don't really know if I want to get into this. And then I started using it. And I have just turned a new page because it does what I want it to do. One of the things that I have found is with those waterproof boxes is that there are some plastic lures that will warp.
Mm.
And you'll get a jerk bait or a crank bait, and it doesn't swim right. And you look at it and you realize it's been in the top part of the tackle box where the sun's hitting it in the old Staples crate.
Yep.
The file crate. And it'll be like curved. And it's not right. It's curved from front to back. Not like it's a mess. So
yeah.
You can't use it. They split sometimes. Some of the crankbaits I use are not very expensive. They work. And thank God they're not expensive, so I buy a bunch of them, but it just pissed me off when I've left it out in the sun. This Feel Free crate actually has a lid on it, and it has rod holders on the side. You can take the rod holders out, strap the rod holder sleeves to the side, and it's just out of the way completely.
Mm-hmm.
And I can fit the five boxes that I've been carrying for years, plus I've got some room for some additional shit for I keep a small other box that just has like, you know, miscellaneous shit that I'm may touch. It's not even fishing stuff. It's not even lures, but like garlic markers. I keep a set of those.
Gotcha.
Little things like that. You know, if I need to doctor a lure. But if we've talked about this before numerous times since you started the show, man. I mean, I carry five boxes.
Yep.
I got crankbaits in one. Most of them are lipless. I've got jerkbaits in another. A good portion of them are floating and the rest are suspending.
Yep.
I've got one for anything with a skirt on it. So, you know, casting jigs, swim jigs, bladed jigs,
yep,
and the few spinner baits that I still carry. That's all in one box. And then I have another one that's like miscellaneous top water and the kitchen sink. Was that five? No, wait, hold on. Did I fuck that up? Crankbaits, jerkbaits.
Skirts.
Skirted stuff.
Yeah.
The top water and one for terminal tackle.
And they're all
3,700 gotcha size. Yeah, those Flambeau tuftainers that I always, you know, advocate everyone using because of those spinnerbait compartments in my terminal tackle box.
Yeah.
That actually becomes very valuable because I put, I've noticed that some brands of hooks survive longer if they stay in their original package. I have no idea how to explain that.
Yeah,
they do. I just keep them in there and then I fold over the top and they fit into that square that I've made in the Flambeau underneath my, that's behind me. And then underneath my seat, I have four, I believe Home Depot's home brand is Husky. Am I incorrect on that? I think it is.
I don't know anywhere else.
Yeah. So Home Depot carries Husky bags. I don't know if anybody else does. I thought it was our home brand.
It's one of, it's, they have a number of home brands. I think it is. It is Husky.
But it's a small bag, maybe about 12 inches long. And, you know, it's for small tools and everything, whatever you want to put in there. I have four of them. I load them up with one for various Ned rig baits, one for stick baits, one of them that splits between paddle tails and tubes, and another one for a certain kind of creature bait I like.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's all I carry.
Yeah.
But the important thing is now I really have begun to love that feel free that I got from Three Bells.
Oh, yeah.
It's wonderful. I believe they carry them too, right?
I think they do.
Yeah.
Lauren will tell us if they do or not. I believe that they do.
So that's my tackle setup. And then we talked last week about the setup I have in the basement. So it's a quick trip up and downstairs once I realize I'm out of a certain trailer paddle tail I use or a certain creature or whatever. And I just keep an eye on that. And if I need to order some, you know, en masse throughout the year, I do it. But I keep things, I try to live by KISS, keep it simple, stupid.
Yep.
I am definitely stupid and I want to keep it simple because the relationship is if you keep it simple, you're keeping your costs down.
Yeah, exactly.
And then you can take that money that you, Lauren is asking what they carry. Lauren, the feel free tackle crates that the one that I won in the raffle at your trifecta, it's mine is like a yellow, gray, white camouflaged. The reason I like that so much over those Staples ones is aside from the sun protection to keep the lures from warping, it's rain protection. It's an added layer of rain protection.
Yeah.
So I've got nothing in there is getting wet. Whereas I have waterproof boxes with gaskets in them. Those Flambeaus, they're great, but it just makes me feel better that now I have two layers of protection from the sunlight,
which
in plastic's enemy is sun, and the rain because, you know, metal's enemy is the water and oxidization. I'm having some trouble pronouncing things today.
It's okay.
Of metal. Yep.
And they do carry them. They're coming in with a shipment of kayaks as well. That's perfect. At Three Bells Outfitters.
Yeah, so they've got those there. I recommend them. And then if you need, you know, you can find your own whatever tool bag or whatever bag, satchel, whatever works for you. It could be one of the Bobby Roast Beef sling bags.
Yeah.
Whatever works for you for your plastics. That's how I do it. But I will say this. The plastics that I carry, because sometimes the bags they come in can be rigid. I know every pro out there will say, keep them in the same bags. Well, if you're using a certain type of scent anyways, throw them into a, what I do is I go to Walmart and they have their own brand. What is it? Great Value is Walmart's house brand.
One of them. Yeah.
Yeah. They have Great Value.
Ziploc bags.
Quart basically. Freezer zipper bags. I buy the zipper ones. I don't like the ones you have to press. I like just zipping it and life's good. And I keep a few extra on the boat. I buy quarts. I think in the basement I have some gallon ones because I think I've over the years purchased like 100 bags of 5-inch stickos from Bass Pro Shops, and I need the gallon ones to fit those in there. But the quart bags will work fine, and then you just wrap them up tight. That's all I do.
Yeah.
And it helps keep the shape a little better, too, especially with, like, paddle tails. It can flop all over the place. That's it. I mean, I keep it simple. Walmart bags, tool bag, Flambeau Tuftainers, and then the Feel Free gigantic crate. That one is a little bit of investment, but I can tell you this. So far this year, with me using it, it's been worth every penny.
That There's makes my sense. Stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it definitely makes sense.
Any questions or concerns, my friend?
From myself, no. But what's interesting, we're talking about storage and organization. This kind of carries into this other thing that's been bouncing around in my head all week this week. It's got to do with – so, Sean, if I say the letters EDC, you know what I'm referring to?
Echo, Delta, Charlie?
Those letters. But if I say EDC, do you know the phrase – everyday carry?
No, I All did right. not know that.
Okay, so there is this thing that I've seen on social media a bunch for years and years and years. And like, if you're like me, you're into gadgets, you're into like creative, like, you know, streamlining the way things work, things like that. Like, so you'll see these posts and there's tons of content about everyday carry. So what happens is you'll have guys that will post like what their everyday carry might be. Sometimes it might be, you know, it might be everything from their gun in their holster to their wallet, their cell phone, their keys, a lighter, a such as, you know, who knows, whatever it is. Well, I started to think about my everyday carry and what I do, the way I carry my stuff day to day. And this kind of all stemmed from me looking into various multi-tools. And I was like, why is it that my everyday carry is so much different than my fishing carry? You know what I mean? The stuff that I'm using, like what really transfers over? Obviously, like, you know, wallet, my phone and things like that, like that's going to go over there. But like, as far as I was thinking about it, I'm like, I've got this one Leatherman and I love it. I use it for all types of different things. And, you know, I don't really feel like it's ideal for fishing. It's very rare when I've utilized it because I usually have a dedicated other set of pliers. So I'm not really worried about that. But, you know, it's like you've seen my lanyard before that's got the braid shears and that little line snip. Looks almost like a nail clipper.
Yep.
And the thing is great. It's awesome. It's getting a little bit beat up. And it might be time to retire it and replace it with something else. But we were kind of exact. Lauren knows. She commented right here, everyday carry. So, yep. You know, it's one of the things. And I just, you know, like I said, I'm a gadget guy. And I put up a post today just kind of talking about it. And basically what I did was I just said, you know, that we talk a lot about it, the gear that we do use on the water. And some of that carries on to our own everyday carry, you know, our own setup. And I asked the question, I said, does your everyday carry have fishing specific or just slightly related tools or tech that are included? And this is like totally selfish, me looking for tips and ideas of things. I found a couple of items that I think I might try and review and see how they work out from various companies. So I don't know. It's just one of those things that I was kind of like interested in. The other thing is this. I want to throw this out here because this is going to slowly become part of the show is truck camping. You know, and I know like you had talked about it as well, like getting into it for some of these longer stints when you're going to be traveling for tournaments and things like that. Like this is something that I think is just partners with what we're doing so unbelievably well. You know, whether you're looking to go and make a killer weekend trip and get two, 3 days out of getting out there on the water versus, you know, going out one day, yeah, fishing in the sticks has lighter scattered about. Yeah, that's probably pretty accurate. You know, it's kind of just it's kind of just one of these things that I feel like partners with what we do on this show really well. So expect to see some of that coming. I don't know. I don't know why I'm even bringing that up right now. Lauren gives a better definition of everyday carry, which I like. She says, it's what you keep on you day to day. It should be a small version of your 10C bag, which is the backbone to your bug out bag. Not to be confused with your ditch bag. So
it's a lot of bags.
Yeah, it's a lot of bags there. A lot of satchels. A lot of preparation happening. You ready for this, Sean?
Well, no, I wanted to wrap up on one other thing.
Oh, yeah, my bad.
This is one of our addendums. Yeah.
Go for it.
All right, you're good. I know, dude, we're chomping at the bit for the FTG. I know. We'll get there. One thing I did want to make mention, you know, we've talked before, the both of us, and I'm sure most of our listeners do anyways. It's not like we require them to pay homage at the altar of Jigs and Bigs and Jigs and Bigs only. But I did read an article.
Yep.
And I sent it to you.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
Almost immediately when, and this is in the theme of keeping things simple.
Yep.
Walker Smith wrote an article for Wired to Fish. I'll be honest. I'm not super familiar with Walker Smith. I actually don't follow a lot of like professional angling. I don't, because I'm focused in on our region here and locally, and that's kind of what I do. And fishing's a weird professional sport anyways, where it's not like fan interactive like other professional sports. It's not like somebody yanks a bass out of the water and there's a fucking bleacher full of people screaming, floating on the water from 50 feet away. Yeah! You know, fucking holding signs up and shit. So,
when I'm getting in this.
Yeah, Walker Smith wrote an article that I swear to God, I know it's common themes among anglers.
Yeah.
It's not like we have the market on it, but it was a basically keep it simple and play to your strengths article. I highly recommend everyone go on a Wired to Fish and read Walker Smith's article, because we've echoed it numerous times in numerous ways over the past 2 years. Definitely check that out. He even brought out he doesn't like the drop shot that much, and I had a little smile. I'm like, this man of my own heart right here. It's my guy. So go check that out, everyone. It was really, really a good read. You've heard some of the stuff from us before, almost verbatim, but it's common threads amongst successful anglers. So if you're looking to take that tournament step or make yourself a better tournament angler, I highly recommend.
Yeah. Reading. Yeah, absolutely. It's nice that when you see something that's completely separate from your circle or anything, like, it almost gives a little bit of validity to what we've been saying here for so long. When you have somebody who's a professional tournament angler saying something, you know, basically echoing your mantra, which you've kind of been saying now for a while, in a publication that's like as huge as Wired to Fish. It does. It's like, you know, it is kind of a cool thing. You're just like, cool. So I'm not here just banging my head against the wall. Like, I mean, this is something that, you know, cool. This is good. Very, very good.
Yep.
That's awesome, man. All right. I think now it is time, if I'm not mistaken. Alrighty, guys.
Dude, Bobby, I'm gonna ad-lib this one.
I'm gonna
roll with it.
You need to.
Look, I gotta give the folks an added bonus, okay? So,
okay.
What I'm gonna do is, this FTG is so, man, it's sketchy as a fishing-related. The only fishing-related part of this FTG was I was doing some fishing activities. I believe Derek from Three Bells was up when this happened. Somebody was in my driveway and we were either unloading or loading something out of my truck that was fishing related. That's why I had to allow this. But I think Zany Radio Guy should tell this story. What do you think?
Oh, I think so too. So yeah, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to give you your little sound effect here. but I have to find it. Oh, I have to find it.
This is a weak FTG. I'm going to go ahead and let you guys know it's weak. I'm going to try and spice it up. Well, we have the means here to spice it up. I'll try. Let me know when Zany Radio Guy when a Zany Radio Guy can deliver an FTG.
Okay. Are you ready? Are you ready? You're ready. You're ready. I can tell you're ready.
And we're back. You know, Bobby, I was outside the other day unloading something out of my truck with a good friend of mine, Derek from Three Males Outfitters.
You were?
And wouldn't you know it, I live on a busy street. And some dickbag drove by and threw a chocolate donut at us. Whoa! I said, that could have taken a fucking eye out. Oh, we're lucky. And fuck that guy.
Fuck that guy. Fuck him. We're morons. I was so excited because it involved a donut. I am such a fat guy. I was so excited. I'm like, I love donuts.
I didn't even save it for you. Went right in the trash.
Was it a whole one, or was this truly Dude Bud style, like munch, munch, bye-bye?
Nope, this was not even Dude Bud style. Dude Bud would have taken a bite and fired it. This was just straight out the fucking window. I'm like,
really?
Well, it didn't hit us. We were pretty easy to hit. I'm a fat guy. I'm tall. Like, I'm a target. If he was going to hit us, he would have hit us. I think he was just throwing garbage. I mean, I found all sorts of garbage outside, on my lawn. Yeah, I don't know.
Man, who does it? What kind of animal does that to a donut?
Fuck that guy!
Fuck him. Oh, my God. There's something wrong with that human being. My God. A donut? Yeah, Lauren says a donut.
Sorry, guys. I didn't really, really. We've been really, really hard up for fuck that guy over the past couple weeks.
It's one of two scenarios have happened. Either the people have been on their best behavior for the past few weeks. I don't buy that for a second. I just think a lot of people haven't been out to engage with the douchebaggery or the pure fuckery that happens on many an occasion out on the water. So with less of us getting out there fishing I am very excited about the ice fishing. We'll call it the iced fuck that guy. You know, like an iced coffee.
We're going to load up on that. I mean, we almost should really never, ever, ever do another double fuck that guy ever again. I know we did a couple of them this year.
Yep.
We could have used them. We could have kept them in our back pocket and spaced them out.
I know.
That's us being irresponsible.
That was such shit a valuable management.
Really valuable resource. So we apologize. And I hope I made it up. Yeah, ring toss.
So
I know they're tossing that.
Potato makes a good point. Now when it was brought to light what the FTG was going to be for this week, that was the first thing I thought of. I was like, well, if you just get one of those plastic Lockwood brand phalluses, you know, it could have been a good opportunity to kind of make it a yard game, a little ring toss, if you will. You know, I don't know how the family is going to feel about having a bunch of mini Lockwoods planted around the hacienda, you know, or if this is going to invite more donut assaults. But, you know, it could be. Let's plant a couple crullers, you know.
Crullers.
Oh my goodness. Okay, seeing as we are between seasons, can we open it up to general FTG? Yeah, absolutely. Lauren, last week, that's actually what we jumped in and said. We're like, you know, we had one where we had opened it up to hunting, you know, for sure. And that was the drive-by deer slaying, if you will. So we opened it up to that. I mean, it's obviously we preferred if we can kind of chime it in there. But if you're out shopping for tackle and there's like just some yahoo in there just shouting, you know, spouting his mouth off or something like that, go for it. It's a great opportunity. Go ahead and leave us a message over at jigsandbigs.com. That orange button says leave a voice note. In fact, the website is getting this winter a refresher. Like it's just gotta, I'd like to streamline things a bit, and because now we've got these segments that we didn't have when we initially put the site together, I want to actually have a button that says fuck that guy, you know, leave a message right there, and it'll be good.
Yeah, we maybe during this dead time when outdoor activities are not drawing the amount of fuck that guy candidates as it does, you know, or as they do during the spring and summer, maybe we should have like, maybe we could re-record Paul's voice saying, off-season, fuck that guy.
Maybe a little jazzy.
We got to note this, like, off-season, fuck that guy. So that gives us the green light to throw assholes under the bus, not in a hunting or fishing-related manner. I mean, this was rough. I mean, we were unloading fishing gear. Maybe this guy didn't like fishermen.
Maybe that's what it was. Maybe it was like, you fishermen!
Yeah.
God damn you anglers!
Yeah. Or he thought, look at that fat fuck. Maybe he's hungry for a donut. I don't know.
Could be. It could have just been, you know, it could have just been a bad throw. Maybe it was like, hey, buddy, have some breakfast.
Yeah. No, fuck that guy. He littered on my lawn. Yeah,
he's a bastard. So. He's a piece of shit. Oh, goodness. Well, at least he didn't judge your Christmas presentation, your decorating skills. Because that is a whole new level of a piece of shit. A whole new level.
I thought I heard the guy as he was going by go, fuck your bushes.
I live on a busy street. Oh, we are. Oh, yes. This is what I want to see right here. Lauren says, Karens, beware. We will call you out. We haven't had a good Karen FTG. Like somebody like just losing their mind about, you know, if you have, even if it's retroactive, a memory, you know, if you want to go back into the archives of like where you may have been wronged, you know what I'm saying? Throw us some of that. We'll definitely be the judge if it makes the cut or not. If you've been wronged on the water in the past, I feel like that little promo in like the People's Court. Have you been wronged? Something like that. Like if somebody did you dirty somehow on the water, maybe it was a couple seasons ago. Maybe you don't necessarily have. Maybe it's a little cloudy. Dig up what you can. We'll try to.
If you were outside, just minding your own business, doing some hunting or fishing related work,
yeah,
and someone drove by and winged a dirty Italian at you from Frigo. That's the dirtiest of being done right
there. That is the dirtiest of being done right there. Oh, what a good sandwich, man. Damn. You know what we did for dinner tonight?
What?
I feel like a smallmouth bass right now.
Hold on. Now the fat guys are talking about food again. Wow!
I feel like a smallmouth bass because we were out again. We were judging Christmas displays with the entire family this time. My youngest was in tow. This was today, and you know we just wanted to run out and grab coffee as a family and just kind of bullshit and listen to some Christmas music and stuff. And the idea of dinner came up, and my wife's like, you know, I really don't feel like cooking. I'm not feeling inspired. And I said, what are you in the mood for? Let's just order something, and then we'll tool around. We'll look at some lights on the way there. We'll do our thing. We'll judge. No, cut that. We'll go ahead and we'll do what we're going to do, and then we'll just grab dinner and go home. So we stopped by one of my favorite seafood spots in the valley, the one and only Crazy Seafood. Haven't been there in a while. And my oldest daughter and I split a huge seafood boil of crawfish. And I taught her the proper way to eat crawfish. She loves them. We got it with the crazy sauce, with the hot seasoning. So like it was a little slap your mama going on. And it was pretty damn good. It was pretty damn good. We enjoyed it. I can't go wrong. So anytime I eat something that I'm just like, this is wonderful. I have a good. I'm gonna make mention here, folks. But yeah, I do. I feel like I am the game fish I like to catch most because I gorged myself on craws today.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Can I make a suggestion? I think that would be just incredibly valuable. Well, you can take it in a completely positive direction or negative direction. That is up to you as
okay.
The official. I'm now dubbing you the official Christmas decoration judge of Western Massachusetts.
It's a title I was born for.
We can go out.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure somewhere we'll have ribbons, like a blue ribbon, like an award ribbon.
Yep.
Maybe either the best or the worst house you've seen. You can talk together with the wife and daughters, gets that ribbon with a Jigs and Bigs sticker, and then you just fucking go up and pin it on something and run away.
Yeah, just leave it on a front step. Just leave it
or
on
knock
the
on their door and say,
with
hi,
a,
I'm Bobby
with a burning
Rose
bag
Beef.
Of poop.
Yeah, don't give them the old, we don't want to give them the old hot foot, but you know, just to let them know, like, hey,
yeah,
Jigs and Bigs, and we're judging the fuck out of your house.
Dude, that's a good idea. Well, I'm from Jigs good. And Bigs, and I'm a piece of shit.
Well, that's if you go the negative way, like, hey, your house sucks.
Your We'd house like to give you this god award. No, I think if you're going to tear anything down, you got to raise up the good. So I think you got to go and be like, this is the fucking biggest piece of shit we have ever seen. Yeah, I kind of like that idea, man. I like that idea.
You're already out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just a matter of...
I mean, this is something we do pretty routinely. Like, if we don't have anything going on, like, on whatever weekend or something, this is like, that's what we'll do, you know?
I mean, the only thing you have to be careful of is you're going to do that.
We laugh, and it's fun.
Well, no. You know, you finally decide on the one, are your wife and daughter is going to be actually okay to be in the car when you knock on somebody's door and say, hey, your house is either the best we've seen all year or the biggest piece of shit. Learn to
maybe
fucking decorate, you idiot.
You know what? Maybe what I'll do is I'll go out with the family and then you and I will go and make them present these.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
I think or that would be a good idea.
Yeah, exactly. Wow.
Maybe we'll just get a bunch of the hoodlums together and we'll go out and we'll go caroling. You know,
break windows.
Delirious has a voice of gold. I'm just saying.
Yeah, there we go.
You know, all right. He can go up and knock on the door, and then Delirious will be there in the clown mask singing the first Noel. Come on, dude. That's every angler's fishing, like Christmas wish.
I'm guessing there's going to be a lot of alcohol involved. I'll probably be driving a small bus for everyone, huh?
You know what I'm learning? There are more and more and more of our peers that are not drinkers.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Good.
It's interesting, yeah. I'm there. I mean, it seems like the ones who do make up for the rest of them, you know what I'm saying? Yes. But I'm realizing that there are a lot of our peers that are not like huge drinkers at all. So, you know, I think this could be a lot of fun. I really do. I think this could be a lot of fun. Just a big old caravan, pickup trucks and SUVs. Oh, fishing in the sticks. Short bus fits, Sean. If I could get my hands on one.
Charged.
Yeah. If I could get my hands on one, I'd be all about that. Just hang a Jigs and Bigs banner off the side of it. Anyway, this has gone entirely in a bizarro direction, but it's been good. And it's, you know, it's the holidays, guys, you know. One thing I would like to mention before we kick over to the next the next break in the show is that the 2021 Christmas Guide, that episode has gone live. And all of the items that we discussed in last week's episode, we put them up the day that the show dropped. We put them up on our story and we put them up with clickable links. Now, obviously, putting something up on our story is one thing, and that's great. But what we did was on our profile, if you go and visit, we actually saved them right to the profile. If you look right at the top of our screen, there's a bunch of circles there where there's a handful of them. There's like five different ones. And the very first one on the left-hand side says 2021 gift guide. If you hit that, you can scroll through the entire gift guide with the links of all of those items that are up for grabs, that are amazing, that we think are fantastic, and go for it. There's one of those items that that is on there, the Booms Velcro straps, the ones that I use for the garment hanger to store my rods in my 4Runner. I did not realize that that company that makes those, Booms Fishing, makes all kinds of stuff. Like, they make pliers and hook removers and like all kinds of different stuff. I did not realize that. So I was looking into that as well. And there's some new stuff over at Reaction Tackle too. So I'm going to be putting in an order myself to sample a few things and we'll check it out. And before we go to break, before we take this break here, Lauren chimes in with what I think is just absolute gold. This is what we should do. We should make Christmas cards with our logo that read this. Dear neighbor, your light display is a disappointment. Consider yourself canceled. Your 85% effort has been noted. Do better next year. Sincerely, and Merry Christmas, Jiggles Bigglesworth.
Jiggles Bigglesworth sounds like Dr. Evil's fucking
it does.
Cat's ancestor.
It does. Yeah, it really does. Jiggles Bigglesworth. I think that is brilliant. I wonder if I can dig it up. I made some Valentines one year for a trivia event that were tremendously X-rated and would have got me. This was like pre all the Weinstein stuff and everything else. They were like very, very inappropriate. And I gave them to all my trivia teams and they had the best laugh. So I think that if somebody gave a Christmas card with that clip, that little quote right there perfectly, I think that would go over well. I think people would enjoy it.
Perfect.
You know, let's do it. Guys, we're going to take a real quick break. When we get back, we've got a little wrap up of the show here. And trust me, you don't want to miss this. We got much more coming up, or at least if nothing else, we got a little bit more. We got a little bit more for you guys. We'll see you after this message right here. Jigs and Bigs is proud to announce that we're being supported by Three Bells Outfitters. Located in Smith Cove on the Niantic River, TBO is Connecticut's premier paddle sports retailer. They're a full service shop specializing in kayaks and paddleboards for everything from recreation to tournament fishing. Three Bells is an authorized dealer of Hobie, Jackson, Feel Free, Native, and Bonafide kayaks, as well as many paddleboard brands. Not sure of what kind of SUP or kayak you want? TBO offers free demos of all
all brands.
Want to go for an extended test drive? They have a full-service rental facility on site. Three Bells also offers a complete rigging service for your kayak with such brands as Yak Attack, Yak Gear, Burley Pro, Yak Power, Torquedo, and more. The sky is the limit. You can visit Three Bells Outfitters in person or online at ThreeBellsOutfitters.com. They ship anywhere in the lower 48 states or order online and pick up at the store. Can't make it to the store to pick up your kayak or worried the freight company might damage your purchase? Three Bells Outfitters offers a white glove delivery of kayaks within a 225-mile radius of their store at a rate less than typical freight carriers. They will deliver your kayak, set it up, and answer any questions you may have. Be sure to follow them on Facebook and Instagram. Don't forget to tell them Jigs and Biggs sent you. Three Bells Outfitters, because life is better on the water. Hey guys, I often get a lot of really good feedback about my beard. Lots of times people actually will ask about what I use for beard care products too. For a long time, it was nothing other than a brush. But things have changed and my beard is styled better and much healthier than it's ever been before. The main reason for this is that I started using beard care products from livebearded.com. Right now, I'm using Live Bearded's beard wash, the conditioner, oil, and the beard butter. I'm also using their bar soap too. In all in matching scents, I should add, the products are 100% natural and they don't leave your beard feeling weighted down or crusty. I've discovered livebearded.com on Instagram and ordered their sample pack of 6 different scents to figure out which one I like the best. I really enjoy the Gunslinger and American scents most. I've been using the sample kit and I really enjoy it, and I've upped it and gotten a full lineup of all their products in the scents that I like. I realized the level of quality that wasn't there in other products that I've tried before. It really did make a huge difference. So I've got a special offer for you. Visit livebearded.com and use my code ROASTBEEF, all one word with no spaces, and you'll receive a 10% discount on your order at checkout. Try the sampler kit for just $10, or go all out and get the full lineup of great products. There's kits available too, and they're great for gifts. And you can even sign up for a subscription. Save a little bit of money, and you'll also find that you won't run out of your favorite beard care products. Check out livebearded.com right now and use the promo code ROASTBEEF to save some cash and look like the epic beardsman you are. You know how it is here. That's about going to do it for us here at Jigs and Biggs. It was a good show. Unfortunately, no interview segment this week, but this is, you know, we were talking before we actually started recording this segment, and this is a weird time of year. I mean, a lot of people have stuff that's crazy that's going on. If they do have open water near them or safe ice, they're out there trying to utilize that before, you know, get the most out of it. So we totally understand that. But we have a couple of guests coming up. I'm not going to drop any names just yet, but we do have a few guests that we're working on getting some dates lined up for, and it's going to be great stuff. So all winter long, we will have some brand new fishing content for you guys. If there is anything at all that we can do for you guys that maybe you want to weigh in, you want to submit maybe a suggestion for a guest or anything like that, we're always reachable via social media. Instagram is the best way to reach us. You can shoot DM over to the Jigs and Biggs account, or Sean the Fisherman, or me at the Bobby Roast Beef account. You can do that too. And, you know, as always, make sure to follow our social media and stuff so that way you know what's coming up, what we have going. Another quick reminder that we're 60 days away from the live 100th episode recording extravaganza. It's going to be amazing. We're working on, you know, we're working with the lighting and stage director from KISS. We're working with, like, I mean, really big names in entertainment here. We're talking about having an opener for you. Harry Styles will be making an appearance. I mean, it's going to be pretty amazing. I am talking out of my ass there. We want to keep things a bunch of surprises for you, but we're working on something that I think you're really going to enjoy. I think so. And it's for a great cause, of course. Sean, you got anything you want to jump in here with before we wrap this sucker up? Put a pretty little Christmas bow on it, maybe.
No, it's getting close to Christmas. Make sure you check out our gift guide. That's up.
Yep.
You know, we threw some good shit at you. Bobby threw a lot of good shit at you.
Yeah, I threw, I went ham with that. I went ham with that. I was like, oh,
you went
We can
you
do
went
this.
Christmas ham with that.
I did a spiced Christmas ham.
Yeah, and the only other thing I can say is take care of each other. It's Christmas coming up. Don't throw donuts at fucking people, passerby.
Yeah,
and,
that's not
that's
cool.
All I can ask.
Not cool, guys. Not cool. Wasting donuts? Who does that? What kind of animal does that? And also, if you're going to decorate your house for Christmas, be ready because I am a piece of shit and I will judge your hard work unfairly and in the best way possible. So with all that said, season's greetings, everybody. We will see you in 7 days with more Jigs and Bigs. Good stuff coming from us. And like we always say, as always, tight lines.
For Christmas, there is just one thing I need. I don't care about the presents underneath the Christmas tree. I just want you for my own, more than you could ever know. Make my wish come true, baby. All I want for Christmas is.
Baby, standing right outside.